If you have your Bible, let's turn together, please, to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. We're in a series of messages called What Now, What Next. And we have seen and experienced a touch of God in these past few months as God has put our lives together. And in preparation for a future that for us right now is unseen, but known fully by God, our hearts are being placed in a ready mode. In the preparation mode, to hear what God has to say and to move in the direction of His prompting. In this particular chapter comes some verses of which you are very, very familiar. You've read these, you've heard these. These words have been taught to you. You may have already memorized them. They're almost a credo when it comes to those who belong to the Lord and are about His purposes. And sometimes the church gets confused. They really don't really understand what is their mission. Why are we here? Some of us feel as though sometimes to be present is to just enjoy a fellowship that's kind of cursory at best. It's not koinonia. We get to see our friends. I mean, we get to hang out with folks that we enjoy. There are people in the room that, man, we can't wait to see from time to time. They're just a blessing to us, and we enjoy them. But that's not the purpose of the church, is to give you a buddy. Not the purpose of the church. And so, you know, the purpose of the church then is to teach. I mean, man, let's teach. And that's one of the purposes of the church. But sometimes, to be honest, most of us in this room, if we're, I don't know, veteran believers, Sunday school graduates is what I call them, sometimes folks like us, the truth is we've been taught so much. Like Amy Grant would sing way back in the day when I was a young, and she'd call them fat baby Christians, you know? And just spoonful after spoonful after spoonful, and we would just get porked up on the gospel, you know, and wouldn't change anything. I believe I probably preached enough gospel in my 40-plus years of ministry to save the world. So what then is the mission of the church? I mean, what are we about to do? I mean, what's the purpose of why we are here? Why has God established us some nearly 200 years ago? What is God doing in the present tense? And what does the future, what's it supposed to look like? When we get to this passage of Scripture, Jesus begins to unpack this for us. And by now you know that this is really where the whole book is moving. If you were to study through the book of Matthew, I preached through the book of Mark. It took me almost 2 years. So I can't imagine what would happen if I went through Matthew. But once you get to Matthew chapter 28, I mean, this is the zenith. Everything is about this. It's not Matthew 16 where Peter confesses that Jesus is the Christ. It's not there, although that's a pinnacle moment. I mean, everything moves toward this. Every miracle moves toward this. Every teaching moves toward this, where Jesus will be gathered with those who are his disciples, and he will begin to give them an assignment, and everything moves toward this place right here. All the gospel moves toward this place right here. This is the jumping off place. I mean, this is the place that changes everything. Now it's not so much spectator as it is participant. Now it's not so much as admiring as in sweat equity that engaging together disciples are about the business of the King. So with your Bibles open to Matthew chapter 28, we'll begin reading in verse 16. And as is our custom, I would invite you please to join with me as we stand together in reverencing the reading of the Word of God. Did anybody here today bring their Bible? Did you bring your Bible? Just lift it up. Look at that. Lots of folks with the Word of God. Fantastic. Here's what the Scripture says. I read from the NIV. And then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. And therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." May the Lord bless the reading of his words. You may be seated. Now, don't look at your notes because you're not going to need them. Okay? This is going to be freestyle. There's been something that's been penetrating my heart through the course of the week that I couldn't really put in a note form. But I just want to talk to you about it, okay? Behind me, you're going to find projected, there's going to be a picture of a lake. And it's an important place because the scripture says that in verse 16, we may not get out of verses 16 and 17. Scripture says that when the 11 disciples went to Galilee, now that's an important place, Galilee. Galilee, if you were to look at a map, and you probably have a map in your Bible somewhere. I have a friend that used to say, man, I believe the Bible from the table of contents to the book of maps. You know, I mean, everything and believe. I mean, he just loved the Lord, loved the Word. And if maybe you have a Bible with maps in them, you could see this. But Galilee is in the northern district, and that's pretty essential. That's really important. As a matter of fact, it skirts the Gentile nations. There was an intermingling of those who were Jewish, Israel, along with the Gentile nations that surrounded them. It was prophesied by the prophet Isaiah that there would be a light that would shine from the north of the northern districts of Naphtali and Zebulun. Those, of course, were the districts of which Galilee now had evolved to become. It was there that the people who were in darkness would be brought to the place where they would see the light. In other words, this was the place that the Bible predicted that the Lord Jesus would set up shop, his messianic ministry. This would be the place that the Lord Jesus would launch what he was to do in this world, redemptively speaking. Okay, it wasn't going to be in J-Town. It wasn't going to be in Jerusalem. It wasn't going to be in the epicenter of religious life. It wasn't going to be among those Pharisees and Sadducees at the temple. Not always, but it would be centralized to a place that was outside of what would probably have been expected. The Lord Jesus is raised in a place called Nazareth. It's on the outer bank, so to speak. It is closely meshed with the Gentile type of culture. The Lord Jesus wasn't very well known there. As a matter of fact, he was indiscreet. But when he came to Capernaum, that was not a small place. That was not a hiding place. That wasn't a place where he could just kind of sit back and do nothing and be unnoticed. Not at all. Matter of fact, one of the major travel routes came around the northern shore attached Galilee all the way down to Africa. And so it was a major thoroughfare. There were many people who were traveling those roads. When Jesus set up shop and made his mission center in Capernaum, that was a pretty notable thing to do. It was a large center. It was on the northern shore. Now, when you look at this picture behind me, it is placed in a place that's called Mount Arbel. A-R-B-E-L. It's known or thought to be known by many scholars much smarter than myself and many theologians who have studied this thing thoroughly. And I don't know where they get this from, but I've researched this and I just agree with them because they just are pretty smart folk. They believe that this was the mountain that the Lord Jesus had assembled together all of his disciples prior to the giving of what you and I call the Great Commission. They believe that this is the place that when you look out from it, you're going to see all kinds. You're going to see a panoramic view of all of the Sea of Galilee. And if you were to take that map that I mentioned beforehand, and if you were to encircle everything that happened on the shores or those city town districts, you're going to see some notable things that would happen. If you were to move up, this mountain, by the way, is in the western quadrant. It is the highest mountain that overlooks the Sea of Galilee. It has a 1,200-foot slope that is gradual, so you're not going to kill yourself to make your way up there, but it's going to take a little bit of a trudge. And once you get up to the top, the stones that the Lord Jesus was there with his disciples are probably the very same stones that are there in the present day. If you were to look over this amazing scene, you would see the entirety of the Sea of Galilee. It's 7.5 miles wide. It is 12.5 miles long. It is all fresh water. There's no salt in it whatsoever. It is teeming with life. It is in the basin whereby the western winds would swoop down and enter into the valley where the Sea of Galilee is and would just stir up the storms. And of course, you can kind of see how that's a part of the gospel story. But if you were to just kind of take a walk from the western coastline and follow it around, you would come to places like Bethsaida. Bethsaida was a place where Jesus called out four of those that would follow him. They were fishermen. If you even stopped at the first place before you got to Bethsaida, you would probably come to a place called Magdala. And Magdala, of course, is what you know to be where Mary Magdalene originated from. And if you know her story, you may already, if you're a believer, you know that she had seven demons in her, right? And that the Lord Jesus, on a particular visit to that area, had delivered her, that she was no longer oppressed by demons, that he freed her from that captivity, and she became a passionate, devoted follower of his all the way to the cross. And she was the one who in the Garden of Resurrection would be there to tend to the body of the Lord Jesus. It was her that the Lord would speak to. So, I mean, she's not some small figure in the gospel account. And so you'd come to that town. It was about 1,000 people, maybe 2,000, a good-sized town for that area at that time. That was her story. You could go to Bethsaida. You would see these four men that were called out. You can read about them in John chapter 1. And you can see their story as well, where they began to listen to John the Baptist. And John the Baptist would say, well, hey, listen, here's the Messiah. Here's the long-awaited one. He's right here. Follow him, basically, is what John said. And so they would attach themselves to Jesus. Where are you from? What are you doing? What are you saying? Well, come and see, is what Jesus would say. Happened right around in that area right there. It's on that western side, a little bit, a northwestern side, that was there that Peter is being restored back to ministry when Jesus invites him to breakfast after he had denied the Lord, failed the Lord, and then Jesus says, come to breakfast and bring those big fish with you. And he restores him. Do you love me? Have that exchange goes on there. So here are these people on the mountain, and they're overseeing the Sea of Galilee. And as they are, they see all of this, all these cities with all these stories behind them, the gospel being lived out from them. I mean, even in Capernaum itself, it would be there that the Bible says that Jesus would teach. He would teach in such a way that people would be astonished. If you move even eastward from where Jesus had headquartered, then you're going to come to some other places, chief of which would be the places where people who had nothing to eat would be fed. First the 4,000, and then the 5,000. Then you come to a city called Chertsey, and it was there that the Gadarene demoniac, who had so many demons in him, he was running around in the tombs, if you remember his story, right? And his story is so sad that when the Lord Jesus encounters him, this demon-possessed person acknowledges that Jesus Christ is Lord. Now, this is on the eastern side, okay? We've made our way to the eastern side. And so Jesus delivers him from the legion of demons and casts those wicked spirits into pigs who run down the mountainside. You could see that cliff if you're overlooking from Mount Herbal, what this whole region looks like. If you were going even eastward, you would see Decapolis, and you would go to those 10 cities, and then you would see the influence of the Gentiles, of which this guy that was filled with demons would go back home to and declare the goodness of God. You could go around time by time by time, and you would see places where the Lord Jesus would manifest his presence. They would manifest his glory, that he would teach like someone who had authority. Isn't it interesting to you that it is to me that the Lord Jesus would station these men upon this mountaintop so that they could get a panoramic view of all the places that ministry had taken place for the past 3+ years? Isn't it interesting to you that the Lord Jesus would take them to the place where he'd spent mostly 70% of his ministry? He would take them to that place, not Jerusalem, not to the places that you would think Messiah would predictably go, but no. Instead, he goes to the north, and the population that has a culture of both Israelite population and Gentile population, he stations them upon a mountaintop, and he has them see all the places that they've been, all the history that's been built, all the messianic purposes that have been unfolded. You can see all this almost in an aerial place. It's a majestic place to stand. I was looking at all kinds of pictures, and I was trying to visualize what it would be like if one day God would let me be a part of a tour or something, and I could see the holy places that the Lord Jesus would do holy things. What would that be like? I mean, it's got to be transformational. It's got to be life-changing, man. And so here you are on top of this mountain that's the highest of all and around the Sea of Galilee, and you're looking at all the places that the Lord Jesus does ministry, and the only word that probably strikes you is the word authority, because the Lord Jesus exercises authority in every one of those places. I mean, after all, right? He has authority over disease. It's in this region, and many others, by the way, that the Lord Jesus heals people. He sees them in their plight. He sees them in their diseased body. He sees them in their desperation. And what does he do? The Bible says, like a shepherd that has compassion, he looks at these people and he begins to minister to them. He begins to bring healing to them. He arrests the medical conditions that they have, and by his authority, he casts out all kinds of illness, and these people who were once not whole are now completely whole because Jesus has authority over disease. Jesus not just has authority over disease, man, he's got authority when he talks. When the Lord Jesus goes to Capernaum and he walks into the synagogue of which he had frequented, when he opens up the scroll and he comes to the place in the prophetic book of Isaiah that says he's coming, and Jesus closes it all up and says, that today has been fulfilled in your sight. Man, listen, you can sense the tenseness of the crowd. They're so upset, they're about to throw him out of the city themselves and down a cliff. But Jesus has authority, and when they take him to the pinnacle of the place where they're going to execute him, he just walks through the midst. Because he's the Son of God, he has authority, man. You're not going to stop him from the mission. Don't even think it. It's from the Mount of that we call the Sermon on the Mount, the most infamous message that the Lord Jesus delivers. It's on the northeastern quadrant of the Sea of Galilee. That's where it's known to be. It was there that the Lord Jesus gives to us what we have inscribed as Matthew chapter 5 and chapter 6 and chapter 7. If you read those final verses in chapter 7, you're going to find out that the Bible says that the people who listened to him were overwhelmed because he taught as one who had authority. And not like one of their religious scribes, not like one of those professional believers, you know, Christians, not one of those guys that can unpack a verse or something and tell you everything about it. Oh, no, he had more authority. When he spoke, people were astonished. They were awestruck. They couldn't get over it. And this isn't the only time. You'll see this over and over again. Jesus is with some folks of his, right? And they listen to him. As they continue to listen to him, now it's dinner time or lunch time, and they don't have anything to eat. Jesus looks at his men and says, hey, listen, we need to feed them. Give them what you got. They don't have anything. But they do come up with a pail box lunch, right? And they've got just a meager bit. And Jesus takes it and multiplies. He's got authority over food, man. He's got authority over food supplies. I mean, he can take that which is meager and he can multiply it out so people who are hungry are able to be fed. And so the Lord Jesus has authority over disease. He's got authority over demons. He's got authority over dumbed down hearts. Jesus has authority over food needs and nourishment concerns. Jesus has authority over everything. And Jesus has authority over death. There are people that the Lord Jesus raises from the dead. The dead, once sealed in the tomb for some 4 days. Another woman from the city of Nain sees her. She's a widow. She has no means of support, man. She needs help. And in her desperation, man, she's just wailing because now here's her son that she's taking on the funeral casket, man. I mean, she's rolling him toward his grave. And she's, you can imagine the despondency of her heart. And the Lord Jesus, what does he do? He raises her son from that funeral procession. He walks into a house and he does the same with a daughter of a man, Jairus. He does the same with the centurion. The centurion says, "Hey, listen, man, I've got a servant that is desperate. He needs help. If you don't help him, he's going to die." And what does Jesus say? "I'm on the way." God said, you don't have to say anything. I understand authority. I get it. You know, I'm a centurion. I've got soldiers that when I tell them to go over here, they go. When I say come here, they come. So you just speak the word. You don't even have to come to my house. You just come up. You just speak the word, and that word will go out before you. And guess what? It wasn't when he was even halfway home where people were coming to him, telling him that his servant had been made well. Now, listen, Jesus has all authority. He has all power. Listen, just so that we're on the same page here, take your Bible and turn with me over to the book of Colossians. You might say, Bob, I don't know where the book of Colossians is. Use your table of contents. I do. If you say, I don't even know how to find it, look on with someone seated close by you that's flipping their pages. They'll help you. Look at Colossians. Look at chapter 1. Look at verse 15. The Son, that's Jesus, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him, for him. He's before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. And so we see the description that Paul gives to the church at Colossae is to remind them of who Jesus is, that he has all authority, that there's no authority beyond his authority, that there's no power that exceeds his power, that there's no presence that can eclipse his presence. When the Lord Jesus steps into a room, something's going to happen. When the Lord Jesus speaks from his mouth, something's going to happen. Because why? He has all authority. Everything is subject to him. Now, by the way, just turn a couple pages back. Made it easy for you. You don't have to go to the table of contents. Check over here at Philippians chapter 2. Move down with me, if you will, to verse 9. Description of the Lord Jesus. Check this out. Therefore, because he's been incarnated, because he's come willing to die, because he's offered his life as sacrifice for sin, therefore God exalted him to the highest place, gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, check this, every knee should bow, in heaven, on the earth, under the earth, in the heavenlies, in the present tense now, in the hell beneath, every tongue, every knee. Check this out. Verse 11. And every tongue will acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So who rules? And who reigns? And who has charge? And who's been given all authority? It is our loving Lord Jesus. Everything, everything, every authority, every power is situated under his feet. Take your Bible. Let's keep going. Turn back some more to Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 6. And this passage of scripture that is well preached. You've heard it. You're aware of this. Look at this in verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take a stand against the devil's scheme. This is in chapter 6, verse 10, Ephesians. For our struggle, look at this, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. In other words, we live in a spiritual world. You can't fool around with it. If you just live in a material world, if you just live for the physical appreciation of all the things that surround you, well, then listen, you're missing everything. If you just live an emotional world where things that just make you happy or make you cry or make you feel fulfilled or make you feel, you know, just you're living a great life. If you just live on that plane, then you're not really living the full life. But when you and I come to the place where we recognize the authority and the power of the Lord Jesus, then every spiritual force that comes against us is rendered meaningless and powerless, because at the name of Jesus, the Bible says that there's going to come a day that everything in the heavens, upon the earth, and below the earth will acknowledge him. And I bet that when Jesus Christ became your Lord, that's what happened to you. You got on your face and you got on your knees. Ever read about that story about that guy that in the Garden of Gethsemane, they came after Jesus with torches and staves? Man, they had a military unit. They had an army platoon. They brought some folks in to arrest the Lord Jesus. Remember what they say with the betrayer at the side? Remember what happens? It's an interesting conversation. Are you Jesus? And Jesus says, I am he. I'm who you're looking for. What happens? The Bible tells us that they fall backwards. These are these guys that came out of boot camp. These are these guys that have been on duty. These are these guys who have been stationed in foreign lands to protect the Roman Empire. They know how to handle a sword. They know how to engage in hand-to-hand combat. They know how to take control of a scenario. But the Lord Jesus says, I am he. Boom! assume they fall backwards. Why? Because he has all authority, and when he releases himself to them, they don't take him by force. They take him because he allows it. He stands before Pilate, right? The governor. Remember this conversation? Interesting thing. They talk about truth. And Pilate says, man, listen, I know you're innocent. I want to get you off the hook here. Don't you know that I have authority over your life? Don't you know that I could crucify you? You remember what Jesus says? Beaten and bloodied. He says, you don't have any authority over me. You only have the authority that the Father gives to you. So act under his authority and do what you're supposed to do. It's amazing to me. You stand. Stand at Mount Arbel. Stand there. And take a panoramic look at the entire ministry of the Lord Jesus, who over 3.5 years exerted authority, caused amazement and astonishment. People's lives by the scores, by the thousands, had been changed. People who were carrying burdens no longer carried them. I mean, people who were sick were no longer sick. They had testimony as to who healed them. Those that were in bondage were now made free. Those who were lost had now been redeemed. I mean, think about this. Go with me, if you will, to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2. Check this out. This is pretty interesting to me. Mark chapter 2, the Lord Jesus has a crowd coming. He's in a house. The Lord's in a house. And he's talking to some folks that are gathered around. There's so many people that they encircle the house, no one else can get in. A few days later, here's Jesus, Capernaum. You could see Capernaum from the mountain. Believe me, people were remembering what was going on in the day when Jesus did this. And the people heard that he had come home. And they gathered such a large number that there's no room left even outside the door. And he preached the word to them. And some men came bringing a paralyzed man carried by four friends. And since they could not get to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it, a thatch roof, and then lowering the mat from the man was laying on. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, son, look at this, son, look at this, son, your sins are forgiven. Now, do you think that guy showed up because that day he was thinking about having his sins forgiven? You think he showed up that day because he just couldn't walk? He just couldn't reach? He needed buddies that would take him to where Jesus is. That's a whole new sermon. I'll get to that one day, okay? I mean, think about the guy that owned the house. I don't know about you, but I'd be fretting. I'd be saying, okay, hold on. Where's the insurance policy? This guy just cut a hole in my roof. Who's going to pay for this? But he looks at this guy and just says, your sin has been forgiven to you. And then people began to scuttlebutt, right? They say, who has authority to forgive sin? Who is this guy that comes marching in here and thinks that he can talk in such terms as this? And they begin to berate Jesus. But what did you do? What's easier for me to do? What's easier? Is it easier for me to tell this young man to take himself up off that pallet and walk? Or to forgive sin. But so you know that the Son of Man has authority on this earth to forgive sin. You take up your pallet and you get up and you walk. Now, I don't know about you. I'd have been pretty convinced. Man, I'd have been all over that. I'd have said, okay, we're not messing around with this Jesus guy anymore. He comes to town. I'm showing up. He's got something to say. I'm listening in. I've got a need. I'm taking it to him. That's the kind of authority. So you look around this lake and story after story, narrative after narrative, biography after biography are being testified to as to what the authority of the Lord Jesus can do. And I'm going somewhere with this, so stick with me, okay? Now go back just a couple pages and let's go back to Matthew chapter 28. So when the 11 disciples went to Galilee, and there are those, I'm one of them, that believe that there were a lot more disciples than this. And I'll show you that if we have time to get to 1 Corinthians 15. They went to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. This was already a sign. They already knew where to be. And when they saw him, they worshiped him. That's the first thing that you would do too. But some doubted. Now, what's that all about? I mean, what's that all about? What are these folks, post-resurrection Jesus, who's already appeared to his disciples? Well, what's this doubt all about? Why does that matter in this text? It matters a lot. Now, there's a word here that I don't want us to miss because it's critical to the text. It's a word, distazo. That's what the word right here, doubt, is translated from. That's important. It's only found two times in the whole of the Bible, in the whole of the New Testament. So you got to pay attention to it because its meaning is important. It means to hesitate, to vacillate. That means to be uncertain. And it's not talking about an intellectual, man, I just lack faith. You know, the word for faith in the Bible is pistis, and you put the ah in front of it, that negates it. That's without faith. That's not the word that's being used here. So this word makes a difference. The only other place that it is found is in Matthew chapter 14, verse 31, and I'll give you a look at that in just a moment. This is the word that means hesitation. It doesn't mean unbelief. It means to be unsure as to what to do when you're in the presence of something and someone so supernatural, like a resurrected Jesus. It is a gathering that they're entertaining that is beyond anything that they've ever known, anything that they've ever seen, everything that they've ever experienced. They know that they're a specific place and the power falls and they don't know what to do. The double clutch. They're hindered. It's kind of like coaching soccer. When we moved to Kansas City, did a little homework there. I didn't know this until we did some looking into the city. That Kansas City had more soccer more children in soccer than any other city per capita in all the country. Every kid played soccer. So my 8-year-old son, we put him in soccer. And what maybe happens here sometimes, you get it everywhere and you find out that dads know who to draft. My son was from Tampa. They ain't drafting him. And dads know who not to draft because they've watched them play. And they said, nah, ain't going there. And so they had a bunch of boys left, and they ran out of coaches. Yeah, it's right. This is what happens. You want to coach a soccer team? I'm looking around. You know, from SEC land, you know, we just play football. Little hoops, you know. But, my son's looking at me. I'm thinking, I'm dead. I got to do this. So I said, sure, I'll do this. Man, I go to the library. Does anybody remember going to libraries? You know, before the Google thing happened, you know? I went to the library. I checked out books on soccer so I could know, how big is this field? When someone says that they're a forward, what does that mean? Who's a midfielder? What does he do? I mean, so I had to learn all these things and how to position stuff, and so I began to study soccer. And we were the bad news bears of soccer. People couldn't wait to play us, man, to puff up their record. They knew, man, that this was a W. We're going against these soccer idiots with their idiot coach. Man, that's a win. I mean, they were letting people that were 4 years younger than my kids play just to have experience. You know? And then we got to the tournament. By that time, I'd learned how to set things up on a field of play. And I said, okay, let's go. Got to passed the first round, passed the second round, started making some noise, passed the third round, got to the fourth round, won the fourth round, went to the championship game on a Sunday. I preached short that day. Got to the soccer match. I said, guys, we go all out. This is the season right here. People have been making fun of you the whole time, but now we go. And man, they had it on. It came down to a shootout. And we won on the shootout. Man, I'm getting all wired up about this right now, even thinking about it. Man, it was awesome. There's nothing like being carried off a soccer field by 12 8-year-olds, man. I mean, it's amazing. But you see, when I was first asked, I hesitated because I'd never been there. I'd never done that. I was unfamiliar with it. It didn't make sense to me. It was foreign. So when you read this word, that's what you read. And it's the very same word that's brought about when you read through Matthew chapter 14, verse 31. Here's Peter, and he's on the boat, and it's rocking because the Lord Jesus now has been to a mountain of prayer. He's looking over this Sea of Galilee. He can see what's going on. The storms are in tumult, and that boat is rocking, and they're taking on water, and he begins to walk. And the guys, they see him. They begin to cry out. We think it's a ghost. And then they say, hold on, that's the Lord Jesus. And Peter says, Lord, if it is you, bid me come to you. And the Lord says, come on. And he gets out the boat and he begins to walk. And you know the story, right? But the Bible says that he begins to sink. He begins to sink. And he cries out a short prayer that all of us should cry out when we're in trouble. Lord, save me. That's all you need. And he does that, and man, he picks him up, and he goes, the same word for doubt is the same word in that text, where he double clutched. He got out of the boat. That's faith. He got out of the boat. Everybody else was in the boat. He began to make his walk. He was walking on top of the water. And all of a sudden, man, the gale winds began to hit him. And the sea spray began to hit him. And man, the waves began to rage. And he took his eyes off the Lord Jesus. Why? Because he didn't have faith. No, he had all the faith that he needed because he was willing to get out of the boat. But he saw his circumstances and he hesitated. And he began to sink. And that's where churches are today. We believe, but then God takes us places that we've never been, and we hesitate. We draw back, and we began to sink. God's going to take New Hope Church in a place that you've never been, and I'm not a prophet. He's going to take you places that you've never been, and many of us in this room who have faith in the resurrected Lord, who look through the panoramic of our lives, and we can see from a mountaintop view. We can see from the mountaintop of our lives the landscape of God's faithfulness to us. We can see it. We can record it. Man, we can go back and appreciate it and thank God for it. And we'll do what these men did. We're going to get down on our knees and we're going to pray. We're going to worship. We're going to be grateful. We're going to be so thankful. But even in that panoramic view, the Lord says, I got another assignment for you. And then it's going to be up to you. Then it's going to be up to our church. We're going to hesitate. When God says, I'm speaking to your transition team, and they're going to lead you to a missional objective, it's not going to look like it's looked before, maybe. There's going to be some things that are familiar, but it may take you places that you've never been. There may be things that you're going to do that are going to be a little uncomfortable, not a part of your history, but they're a part of your future. Will you get out of that boat? And God's going to say, New Hope Church, look at the panoramic. If I were to take you on the mountaintop, look at the panoramic. Look at the big picture. See the view of all the ways that I've been faithful and that my authority has arrested any challenges from the pit. Look at all these things. And you can trust that I will be faithful to you when I give you this next assignment. Does anybody here believe that, by the way? Am I just talking in the wind? Won't be the same. And that ain't bad. So stand with me because I want to pray for you. Sometimes the Lord puts us in places where we feel as though on the mountain, even then, it's impossible. It blows our minds. We haven't even gotten to the assignment yet, but it really looks as though it's way beyond us. But the Lord is telling us here this morning, and I want you to get this, that he says to us, I have been faithful to you, and I have all power. You can rest in my authority. Let's go. Never say what you never would do, but Lord, I know that often that you don't take us to familiar places, and we get into unfamiliar places. We need to see the history of your faithfulness, because otherwise we'll hesitate. We'll draw back. go back to the boat because that's where we think it's safe. We'll go back, Lord, to customs and behaviors and maybe past things that were successful in past days because you spoke them to us in those ways. Lord, if we don't know our mission, then we're going to be messing around. You won't bless a church that messes around. Lord, if we're concerned chiefly with just having fun and enjoying each other, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's not the chief mission. If we're all overwhelmed, Lord, with teach, and there's nothing wrong with it. Teach, I mean, the word disciple means learners. Learners have to be taught. Would you put us on mission? Would you give us a target? Would you move within us, Lord, so there'll be a prompting of next steps that are unique to this, your church? To start now. And before you raise your heads, I want you to know that where you have been seated this past hour has been prayed for. Every seat in this sanctuary has been prayed for. You have been prayed for before you got here. Lots of people were here Wednesday night. They walked up and down these rows. They touched every chair. They prayed for you. We didn't know where you would sit. We didn't. If there's anyone here today in this your church who says, Lord, help me with my hesitation. Help me, Lord. It seems too big and too much, too hard. If you're that person that wants to surrender your hesitations this morning, leave them at the cross or leave them here at the altar, these stairs. If you would be willing to lay them down here today, trusting the Lord to fulfill his mission in the future that he has for you, I want to encourage you to do that. And I pray that you will. A willing spirit. A spirit that says yes, Lord. So we're just going to open up the altar for people just like you. I lay down my hesitation. If there's someone here this morning that would like to have a relationship with Jesus, you've heard about him. He's been declared, he's been preached. And you want to place your trust in him, come see us. We'll be here, ready to minister. You join God's church because you're a believer and you know this is all he has for you. Then you come on. See one of us. Help. Courage. Bless you. But today I feel a sense, Lord, that you're calling your people to look at the scene of your faithfulness to lay down their hesitations. So, Lord, I'll ask you to draw.
Let mercy fall.
I just believe that God, this is a word for God's church for now. And so this is last call, okay? I don't prolong things. I'm not the Spirit, but the Spirit does, and I'm good. All right, so this is last call. You need to lay something down. You need to get rid of a hindrance. You need to move away from hesitation. You need to be a part of what God wants to do in the future. You want to release all that to Him and yield in this. Then you come, all right? You come. If you need anything else, just look at me. Our eyes will lock and I'll know to come to you. Okay, you ready? Let's sing, you respond.
So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. And conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
if you can conquer graves, you can build churches. Lord, you can export your message of salvation to the masses. And Pell City is no problem for you. And Lord, making disciples is not a problem for you, but it's your command to us. And so, Lord, I pray that you move us in places whereby this command can be fulfilled by these, your good people at New Hope Church. I ask, Lord, that for every prayer that's been prayed this morning, for everything that's been released to you, for every concern that's been voiced to you, that, Lord, here this morning you'll grant. You'll grant freedom. You'll grant response, answers, that you'll reveal your wonderful power, your mighty majesty, your eternal authority. And I pray, Lord, there'll be victories. Victories for those who are praying for souls. Victory for those, Lord, who want to be a part, not participating yet, Lord, but want to be fully engaged. I pray, Lord, today that we've just been released of all the hesitation because we've seen your faithfulness. We are yours. This is my prayer I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, now before you leave here today, I want to encourage you to go by the resource table over there and pick up some invite cards. Easter's coming, and man, I tell you, I've read studies that say nearly 90% of people who are invited by a friend will come when they're invited by a buddy. So go pick up some cards and be a part of that. And I look forward to seeing you on Wednesday for prayer. God bless you.